of our lectures returned to Umm Qur with Sheikh Ali Hassan al-Halabi, Sheikh Salim al-Hilali, and Sheikh Abu Sahib al-Salam. Today, Sheikh Ali will deliver a talk on Bidah, the causes and the cure. Jazakum Allah khairan. Thank you.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار وبعد فإن الكلام في البدعة وأسبابها ومضارها كلام مهم جدا وكثير جدا. هو مهم جدا لأنه يرتبط بحياة المسلمين وتطبيقاتهم العملية وما يتعلق بشؤونهم الدينية. وأما أنه كثير جدا فلأن هنالك أحاديث كثيرة عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم، وكذلك هنالك آثار متعددة عن سلف الأمة الصالحين رضي الله تعالى عنهم، كل ذلك تحذيرا من البدع وبيانا لأخطارها وكشفا لمضارها.
In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful, verily all praises for Allah, Lord of all the worlds, and peace and blessings may be upon His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Verily, the most truthful of all speech is the Book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of affairs is the innovated affairs, the newly invented affairs. For every newly invented affair, every bid'ah is in the fire. Verily, this topic, or speaking about this very important topic, the topic of innovations, the topic of bid'ah, and its causes and its reasons and its harmful effects, is very, very important, and is a very lengthy talk also. As regards to it being very important, that is because it is connected with the life of the believer, his practical everyday living, and also is connected with his worship and his ibadat. As for it being a lengthy talk, that is because, or it being lengthy, this discussion about bid'ah, that is because there are many ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in which he explains the evils of innovations, and also there are many athar, many narrations from the salaf talking about bid'ah and warning us about it and making clear their evil. نعم.
من أجل ذلك كان النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام يحذر من البدع تحذيرا كثيرا، وذلك في سائر مواعظه وخطره. ونحن قد افتتحنا، بل إننا نفتتح دروسنا وخطبنا ومواعظنا بخطبة الحاجة. وخطبة الحاجة هي السنة التي كان نبينا عليه الصلاة والسلام يكثر من ذكرها بين يدي، أو يذكرها بين يدي كل خطبة أو موعظة أو درس من دروسه وخطبه عليه الصلاة والسلام. وإذا نظرنا في خطبة الحاجة رأينا أن أهم ما تذكره وتكرره وتحذر منه هو البدع وبيان خطرها وشرها. لذلك كان يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام: فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. هذا بيان للجانب الإيجابي، جانب الكتاب والسنة الذي يجب اتباعه ويجب الانصياع إليه ويجب الدعوة له والاجتماع عليه. ثم بعد أن يذكر الجانب المضيء المشرق يحذر من الجانب المظلم، من الجانب السيء الذي يغرق الناس أنفسهم فيه ويوقعون أنفسهم في ظلمه وظلامه وهم يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا. فإذا به عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم يقول: وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. تأملوا أيها الإخوة الأحبة هذه التحذيرات المتوالية المتتالية: وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وما هذا التوكيد، وما هذا التكرير، وما هذا التشديد إلا ليتنبه المسلمون ويحذروا من البدع وخطرها ومقدماتها ونتائجها وآثارها، حتى يجتنبوا ذلك كله ويحذروا منه ويحذروا إخوانهم عنه.
Because of this very important topic, the very important issue of innovations, bid'ah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would warn the people about innovations very much. We find from his guidance that all of his speeches, all of his khutbahs that he would give, his sermons, and all of his lectures that he would give, and all of his admonitions that he would give, he would start off by mentioning the khutbatul haja. And we also started this talk by mentioning the khutbatul haja. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in starting off any of his speeches, in starting off any of his sermons or his admonitions or any of his lectures, he will start off by mentioning the khutbatul haja, and that is what we also started off our speech with. And we find that the most important thing that is mentioned within this khutbatul haja, one of the most important things mentioned in the khutbatul haja, is the warning of innovations, bid'ah, and in the explanation.
Afwan, brothers.
So we find in explaining the importance of or the evils of innovations from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was that he would start all of his khutbas, all of his talks, and all of his sermons by the khutbatul haja, and that is that khutbah, that sermon that we mentioned also at the beginning of our speech. And we find that the most important thing mentioned in this khutbatul haja, or one of the most important things mentioned in this khutbatul haja, is an explanation of the evils and the dangers of innovations and the evil. So the Prophet ﷺ would say, verily the best speech is the speech of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in this part of his speech, or this part of his sermon, the Prophet ﷺ would tell the people about that which is obligatory to follow, that which a person should follow and be obedient to. And then, on the other hand, the Prophet ﷺ would warn the people about the evil and about the other side, the dark side, and that is the side of innovations. So he would say, verily the most evil of affairs are the innovated affairs. For every innovated affair or every newly invented affair is an innovation. And every innovation is astray, and everything that is astray leads to the hellfire. So here, the Prophet ﷺ clearly and emphatically explains the evils of innovations, and all of this by way of emphasis and by way of harshness, to explain to the Muslims that and warn them about these innovations, about their evil consequences and about their dangers.
وأما الأسباب التي من خلالها تظهر البدع وتنتشر وتنتج عن ظهورها وانتشارها النتائج الخطيرة والأضرار الكثيرة، فإنها كالتالي: أولا الغلو والتعصب. والغلو هو مجاوزة الحد في الأشياء والأمور. الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام يقول: إياكم والغلو في الدين، فإنما أهلك من كان قبلكم غلوهم في أنبيائهم. لذلك كان الالتزام شيئا يختلف عن الغلو. بعض الناس يظنون أنك إذا غلوت وقمت بالغلو على وجه الكثرة أو الشدة كان ذلك التزاما منك بالدين والتزاما منك بالشريعة، وهذا خطأ كبير، فإن الغلو شيء يختلف ويغاير الالتزام والثبات على الدين. الغلو عادة يصاحبه التعصب ويصاحبه الجهل، بينما الثبات يصاحبه اللين ويصاحبه العلم وتصاحبه المعرفة ويصاحبه الفقه الذي هو علامة إرادة الخير من الله سبحانه وتعالى لعباده، كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. ولقد أشار النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام إلى هذه العلامة، أعني أو إلى هذا السبب، أعني الجهل والغلو والتعصب، في حديث صحيح صححه الإمام أحمد وغيره عنه عليه الصلاة والسلام يذكر فيه الأسباب الأساسية التي تنشأ عنها البدع، وهذا أولها، وسنذكر السببين الآخرين بعدها. أما الحديث فهو قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام: يحمل هذا العلم من كل خلف عدوله. وقوله من كل خلف أي من كل جيل وفي كل عصر. عدوله هم العلماء، العدول، الثقات، الأثبات. ما هي مهمتهم وما هي وظيفتهم؟ يحمل هذا العلم من كل خلف عدوله، ينفون عنه تحريف الغالين وانتحال المبطلين وتأويل الجاهلين. فالنقطة الأولى أيها الإخوة في الله التي هي الجهل والغلو والتعصب يشملها قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام: ينفون عنه تحريف الغالين. تحريف الغالين، فالغلو ينشأ عنه التحريف والجهل ينشأ عنه التعصب. لذلك كان من أعظم أسباب البدع وانتشارها ووجودها التعصب والغلو الذي ينشأ عنه الجهل بالدين.
And as for the causes and the reasons which makes the innovations apparent in the society and makes them spread and makes the evil consequences and the dangerous consequences and the harmful effects, then there are very many. And so we will explain them as follows. First of all, the first reason for the spreading and the appearance of innovations is al-ghulu, which is going into extremes or going overboard, and ta'assub, which is narrow-mindedness. As for ghulu, then the definition of ghulu is going above those borders put by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and going above those affairs and those situations, and going into extremes. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith: beware of going into extremes with regards to the religion, for verily those people before you were destroyed because of them going into extremes with regard to their prophets. The hadith is, the Prophet often said, beware of going into extremes with regard to the religion, for verily those that were before you were destroyed because of them going into extremes and excesses with regard to their prophets. And some people, and a point the Shaykh wanted to make here, was the difference between al-iltizam, which is being steadfast and firm upon the deen, and going into extremes. And some people think that being strong upon the deen or going into extremes in the religion, this is from iltizam, this is from being firm upon the deen, but this is a mistake. For verily, being firm upon the deen is always based upon knowledge. You'll find the person that is firm upon the deen will always be firm upon knowledge, will always be compassionate, will always be soft, will always be kind. Whereas the person who is going into extremes, then naturally, or most of the case, then he has this narrow-mindedness with him, and also ignorance, and also he is normally an ignorant person. And this is also made clear from the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, that is, that a person who is firm upon the deen will always have this good understanding of the religion, and will be firm upon knowledge, and will be soft. This is from the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, that whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intends good for a person, He gives him understanding of the deen. So as regards to this point, the point that the first reason we wanted to mention, which makes bid'ah innovations apparent in society, and that is ignorance, that is going into extremes and being narrow-minded, then this is from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which explains to us this very important point. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that this religion will be passed on by in every generation by udul, those trustworthy scholars, and they will remove from it and from this religion all of the innovations of those that went into extremes, all of those things which those people who went into extremes caused going astray from the correct path. This is the first part of this hadith the Shaykh wanted to mention. The hadith is a long hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad. The beginning of this hadith is that this deen will be carried by, and every generation will be carried by scholars, udul, ulama, people that are firm upon this religion, and they will remove from this religion that was introduced by those people that went into extremes. So verily, ghulu, extremism, is a reason for a reason and causes an inhiraf, which is going astray and straying away from the correct path. And ignorance is a reason for at-ta'assub, which is narrow-mindedness. And verily, these are the greatest of all reasons for innovation spreading.
وهذا الجهل الذي ينتج البدع ويكون سببا من أسبابها آثاره تظهر في ثلاثة أمور. أما أولها فهو الجهل بالسنة، فبقدر ما يكون الإنسان جاهلا بالسنة بقدر ما تصدر منه البدع والمحدثات، وبقدر ما يصدر عنه الأمور المخالفة لشرع الله عز وجل ولسنة نبيه عليه الصلاة والسلام. ومن ذلك أيضا في هذه النقطة نفسها أنه تختلط عليه الأحاديث الصحيحة بالضعيفة، فإذا به بسبب جهله بالسنة صحيحها وسقيمها، إذا به يظن الصحيح ضعيفا والضعيف صحيحا، فيستدل بالضعيف على أنه دين، ويرد الصحيح على أنه ليس من الدين، وما هذا إلا بسبب جهله وعدم معرفته وقلة علمه الذي أنتجت أو التي أنتجت الغلو والتعصب، بحيث لا يستجيب لنصيحة ولا يقبل دعوة ولا ينصاع لتوجيه أو إرشاد. وأما نقطة ثانية فهي جهله باللغة، فإن الجهل باللغة العربية في هذا الدين سبب كبير من أسباب وقوع البدع ومن أسباب ظهور المحدثات والمخترعات ومن أسباب انتشارها. فكم من الناس قرأوا آية من كتاب الله أو حديثا من أحاديث رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، ولكنه يفهمه على غير وجهه، فإذا به يطبقه تطبيقا سيئا. وأنا أذكر أمثلة على ذلك. أما الأول سؤال وردنا هنا في المجلس الماضي أو الذي قبله، فيه ذكر قوله تعالى: إن الصفا والمروة من شعائر الله، فمن حج البيت أو اعتمر فلا جناح عليه أن يطوف بهما. يقول السائل: فمعنى قوله لا جناح أي أنه ليس واجبا، وبالتالي فإنه يجوز للمسلم كما هو ظاهر النص أن يطوف بين الصفا والمروة، كما أنه يجوز له أن لا يطوف. هذا بسبب ضعف اللغة العربية وعدم معرفتها، فرفع الجناح لا يلزم منه أن هذا الذي رفع الجناح عنه، وكلمة الجناح بمعنى الإثم أي فلا إثم عليه، ورفع الجناح في مسألة ما لا يعني أنها ليست واجبة، بل إن الأدلة كلها تدل على وجوبها، ولا يلزم في لغة العرب من رفع الجناح عدم الوجوب أو عدم الفرض. لو أن هذا الأمر عرف في لغة العرب لما وقع ذلك الفهم الخاطئ لهذه الآية الكريمة. وهذا يرجع أيضا إلى النقطة الأولى، وهي الجهل بالسنة، وهي الجهل بالسنة. فلو أننا عرفنا في السنة المطهرة أن السعي بين الصفا والمروة هو واجب وفرض، بل ذهب بعض أهل العلم إلى أنه ركن لا يتم الحج بدونه، لعرفنا أيضا أن ذلك الفهم لقوله تعالى فلا جناح عليه ليس صحيحا ولا دقيقا. ومثلا آخر بسبب الجهل باللغة، أو منشأه وسببه الجهل باللغة، هناك حديث فيه أن الرسول عليه الصلاة والسلام نهى عن الحلق قبل الجمعة. والحلق جمع حلقة، أي حلقات العلم قبل يوم الجمعة. فإذا ببعض الناس من أهل العلم يفهم أو يقرأ كلمة الحلق الحلق، والحلق هو قطع الشعر فقط، عبارة عن تشكيل الكلمة، جهل حكما ووقع بحكم مغاير. قال: فظل سنوات كثيرة لا يحلق شعره يوم الجمعة، ظنا منه أن الحديث نهى عن الحلق قبل الجمعة، والصواب أنه نهى عن الحلق قبل الجمعة. فتأملوا الجهل باللغة كيف يوقع ببدع ومحدثات وأمور منكرة لا أساس لها ولا أصل لها.
Regarding this issue of ignorance, and that which is a result of this ignorance from the spreading and the innovations becoming apparent, and this ignorance being a reason for these innovations spreading, then we want to mention three points with regard to this ignorance and what it's associated with. The first point is ignorance with regard to the Sunnah. So just as a person is ignorant regarding the Sunnah, then as much as he is ignorant regarding the Sunnah, then this is how much he will fall into innovations and newly invented affairs. So this is directly proportional to his knowledge of the Sunnah. Him falling into innovations is directly proportional to his knowledge of the Sunnah. And from this also is his knowledge of, confusing with regard to those ahadith which are sahih and those ahadith which are da'if, which are inauthentic. So the person may think that which is authentic is inauthentic, and he may think that which is inauthentic as being authentic. And this can be a reason for him falling into innovations. This is because of his little knowledge with regard to the Sunnah. And again, this may also lead him into ghulu, which is extremism, and ta'assul, which is narrow-mindedness. So it may end up him thinking, because of this, what he thinks is being the correct, he won't accept the nasiha of the other people, nor will he accept their guidance and when they want to set him aright. The second point the Shaykh wanted to mention with regard to ignorance was being ignorant of the Arabic language. And this can many times be a reason for a person falling into mistakes and falling into thereby innovations, and also their spread. So many people, they read a hadith or they read a Quranic ayah, but they don't understand this Quranic ayah or this hadith correctly. So they interpret and they act with this hadith in an incorrect manner. And the Shaykh wanted to give two examples of this. The first example being a question that came to him in one of the previous sittings here in this place. And that was an individual, a brother, asked a question with regarding the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily the Safa and Marwa are from the signs of Allah. And whoever wants to make tawaf, and he wants to go around them, then there's no sin upon him. So this questioner said, this statement of Allah that there's no sin upon him, la junaha alayhi, it means, for example, that it's not wajib, it's not obligatory for me to make sa'i. So I can leave the sa'i when making hajj or when making umrah. And this is because this understanding of this ayah was based upon his ignorance of the Arabic language. Because this statement, that la junaha alayhi, or this removal of any sin in making this sa'i between Safa and Marwa, does not mean that this action is not obligatory. This statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that there's no sin upon the person making Safa and Marwa, making the sa'i between Safa and Marwa, this statement of Allah does not mean necessarily that it is not obligatory to make sa'i between Safa and Marwa. Rather, if we were to look into the sunnah, we would know that the sa'i between Safa and Marwa is obligatory. And this goes back to the first point of the questioner from the question, that is his ignorance of the sunnah also. And some of the scholars, the Shaykh said, went on to say, some of the scholars not only considered the sa'i to be wajib, but some of them also considered the sa'i to be a pillar of Hajj and Umrah. The second example the Shaykh wants to give of being ignorant about the Arabic language and how it can lead to misunderstandings and then thereby innovations is the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, where he said the Prophet ﷺ forbade al-hilq before the Jummah prayer. And hilq in Arabic language is the plural of halq, which means a gathering or circles of knowledge. And one of the previous scholars, he understood this word to mean halq. He just changed the way the word is pronounced, and halq means to shave a person's head. So this person, this individual, for many years considered it to be haram for the person to shave his head before the Jummah prayer, and of course this is based upon his ignorance of the Arabic language.
وأما المشكلة الثالثة التي تنشأ أو التي تنشئ الغلو والتعصب والجهل وتنشأ عنها فهي القياس والجهل بأصوله وضوابطه، بمعنى أن القياس الشرعي الصحيح هو الذي تنضبط علته ويكون معروفا وواضحا، ومن خلاله يتم القياس الصحيح في أصوله الصحيحة. أما إذا جهل معنى القياس وجهل حكمه وجهل ضوابطه، فإن الواحد من هؤلاء الجهلة قد يدخل في الدين بسبب قياسه المغلوط أمورا ليست من الدين، وقد يخرج من الدين أمورا بسبب قياسه العقلي هي من الدين لكنها لم توافق عقله ولم توافق رأيه ولم توافق قياسه المبني على الجهل هذا. وكم من الناس اليوم نسمعهم يقولون هذا أمر في مسألة إذا ذكرت لهم أو قيلت أمامهم، هذا أمر لا نعقله، هذا أمر لا يدرك بالعقل، أو هذا أمر يخالف العقل، هذا كله بسبب عدم ضبط القياس بوجهه الصحيح. وإلا لو عرفنا أن القياس له حدوده التي لا يجوز تجاوزها لعرفنا أن العقل كذلك له حدوده لا يجوز تجاوزها. فكما أن لأية حاسة من البدن قدرة تصل إليها، كالعين لها قدرة في الإبصار قد تكون كيلو مترا واحدا أو اثنين أو ثلاثة، ثم أكثر من ذلك لا يكون إبصار. وكذلك السمع قد تسمع ما في هذه الغرفة، قد تسمع ما في الشارع، قد تسمع ما في البيت الذي بجانب بيتك، لكن لا تستطيع أن تزيد على أكثر من ذلك، لأن حاسة الإبصار تكون قد آتت قدرتها وانتهت قوتها. وكذلك العقل تستطيع أن تدرك المحسوسات، تستطيع أن تدرك المرئيات، تستطيع أن تدرك كثيرا من الأمور، لكن هل تستطيع أن تدرك كل الغيبية؟ هل تستطيع أن تدرك كل الأمور التعبدية التي تعبدها الله عز وجل أو تعبدك الله عز وجل بها؟ الصحيح أنه لا يدرك ذلك كله بالعقل، وإنما يدرك بعضه. فما أدرك نؤمن به ونلتزم به وتنشرح صدورنا له، وما لم يدرك نقول إن عقولنا قد قصرت عن إدراكه، فلا يجوز إدخال القياس وإعماله بغير دليل وبغير ضابط وبغير حجة، فإن ذلك سيؤدي إلى أن ندخل في الدين ما ليس منه، وإلى أن نخرج من الدين ما ليس منه.
The third reason the Sheikh wanted to mention, or the third difficulty, which is a reason for the spreading of ghulu, extremism and ta'assub, narrow-mindedness, is al-qiyas, and ignorance about its general principles, al-qiyas being analogy, and the person being ignorant about its general principles and its conditions and the way it is applied correctly. For verily, qiyas, analogy, has its specific rules and the principles regarding it, and this is well known to the people of knowledge. So a person who is ignorant of the meanings of qiyas is ignorant of its correct principles and its dawabits, its general outguiding rules, may enter into this deen by way of his qiyas, something which is not from the deen. He may, by using his qiyas, which is not based upon the correct principles, the correct fundamentals, he may enter into this deen, that which is not from this deen. And he may also, because of his using his aql, using his mind or his intelligence, he may negate something or deny something from the sharia because his intelligence doesn't allow it, doesn't comprehend it. So there are many things which we are not able to understand, our minds aren't able to comprehend and to perceive. And verily, our intelligence is like all of the other senses. So, for example, we have eyes, and eyes can see to a certain distance, perhaps 1 kilometer, perhaps 2 kilometers. But beyond that, our eyes are unable to see. And our hearing, we're able to hear, for example, what is going on in this room, or what is going on outside in the streets. But beyond this, we're not our hearing is unable to hear. Our ears are unable to hear. In the same way, our minds have their boundaries, have their limits, beyond which our minds aren't able to comprehend, aren't able to perceive. So we say that which our minds are able to understand, then we follow, and we say all praises due to Allah. And those things which our minds are unable to understand, are unable to conceive, from the affairs that are hidden to us, the ghaybiyat, ilm al-ghayb, those things that are unknown, unseen to us, which our minds are unable to perceive and understand, then we say that we do not allow our intelligence to come and deny these things, and to use this qiyas, this analogy that is based upon the wrong principles. Rather, we accept everything that comes from the deen.
هي تفصيلات للسبب الأول الذي هو الغلو والتعصب المنشئ للجهل والمحدث له. وهذه النقطة الأولى هي التي أشار إليها الحديث الذي ذكرناه آنفا، وهو قوله عليه الصلاة والسلام: يحمل هذا العلم من كل خلف عدوله ينفون عنه تحريف الغاليب. وهناك نقطة أخرى وهي انتحال المبطلين، انتحال المبطلين. فالمبطل هو الذي يتبع الهوى في الأحكام. فالنقطة الثانية إذن هي متابعة الهوى في الأحكام، بمعنى أن تأخذ من الدين ما تهواه وما يوافق هواك وما يوافق رأيك ومصلحتك، ثم ترفض منه ما يخالف هواك ومصلحتك ورأيك. تأخذ منه ما توافق عليه، ما نقل عن آبائك وأجدادك وعرف أعرافك وعاداتك وتقاليدك، ثم ترد منه ما خالف ذلك وما غايره وما ناقضه. والله عز وجل يقول: ومن أضل ممن اتبع هواه بغير هدى من الله، ومن أضل ممن اتبع هواه بغير هدى من الله. فمتابعة الهوى في الأحكام سبب من أعظم أسباب البدع، لأن كل من هؤلاء المتبعين للهوى ينشئ دينا على وفق ما يهوى، وينشئ عبادة على وفق ما يهوى، ويرد سنة على وفق ما يهوى، ويقبل مبتدعة أو في الأمور على وفق ما يهوى. فهذا سبب رئيسي يجب النظر إليه بدقة والحذر منه بشدة.
These three points that we previously mentioned, they were an explanation. They were an explanation of the first reason which a person, or the first reason which brings about innovations in a people, and that is al-ghulu, or extremism, and ta'assub, which is narrow-mindedness, which is based upon ignorance. That was based upon the first part of the statement of the Prophet ﷺ, in which he said, "Verily, this knowledge will be carried by in every generation by the udul, the trustworthy people, and they would remove from it the deviations of those that went into extremes." The second part of this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, and also those people who would follow their desires. So this is the second reason that a people would fall into innovations, and that is following of one's desires. So we find this person, the Mubtil, he is the one that follows his desires in everything. So he takes from his religion that which is in accordance with his desires, that which is in agreement with his desires, and that which will benefit to him, that which comes from his forefathers, that which is coming from his culture. And then he rejects in the same way, in the same fashion, that which is in disagreement with his desires, is not of advantage to him, which is going against the way of his forefathers. The Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "And who is more astray than the one who follows his desires without a guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?" So verily, following one's desires is from the greatest of all reasons for falling into innovation, and its spreading, and its development. Taking this following of the desires as religion, so he follows that which is in accordance with his desires. So, and he rejects from the sunnah that which is against his desires. So here, this is a point that we should take care of, and we should be very precise about, and we should take care and ponder over this affair, and that is the following of one's desires.
والنقطة الثالثة أشار إليها الحديث نفسه. يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام في ذات الحديث: يحمل هذا العلم من كل خلف عدوله، ينفون عنه تحريف الغالين وانتحال المبطلين وتأويل الجاهلين. وتأويل الجاهلين، فالجاهل في الشرع يؤول ويحرف أحكامه على حسب ما يمليه عليه عقله، وهو ما عبر عنه بعض أهل العلم بقوله: تحسين الظن بالعقل في الشرعيات. وقد أشرنا إلى شيء من ذلك في النقطة الأولى، وهي متعلقة بالقياس، ونزيد على ذلك بأن نقول: إن أول من جعل العقل في القياس ضد أحكام الشرع هو إبليس، إذ أمره الله عز وجل أن يسجد لآدم، فقال قائسا وقال محسنا ظنه بعقله: خلق أنا خير منه، خلقتني من نار وخلقته من طين. هذا استعمال للقياس العقلي في مواجهة النص الشرعي. الله جل في علاه يقول لك: أسجد لهذا، وإذا بك ترفض ذلك وتأباه وتمتنع منه، جاعلا عقلك هو الحكم، وجاعلا قياسك الباطل هو الحكم، فكان منه أن خرج من الجنة وأن صار لعينا إلى يوم الدين. وهكذا كل من جاء بالعقل وبالأقيسة العقلية بمقابل النصوص الشرعية يكون له نصيب مما كان لإبليس، حيث واجه النص بعقله ورده بقياسه والعياذ بالله تعالى. والواجب في ذلك للمسلم أن يكون مستسلما لأمر الله، وما كان لمؤمن ولا مؤمنة إذا قضى الله ورسوله أمرا أن يكون لهم الخيرة من أمرهم، أن يكون لهم الخيرة من أمرهم. والله عز وجل يقول: فلا وربك لا يؤمنون حتى يحكموك فيما شجر بينهم ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت ويسلموا تسليما. هذا هو الواجب وذاك هو المردود. والأصل أن يقوم المسلم بحق واجبه الذي أمره الله تبارك وتعالى به دون أن يغيره إلى غيره مما يحسن به الظن على غير قاعدته وعلى غير وجهه.
The third reason that I want to mention that causes innovations to spread and causes innovations to appear is that also mentioned in this very same hadith. And that is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said, "Verily this knowledge will be carried by trustworthy scholars of every generation. They will remove from it the extremism of the people going into extremes and those who follow their desires, and also the ta'wil of the jahileen, the false interpretations of the ignorant people. So verily the ignorant person, he understands and he interprets and he explains away the religion and he explains away its rulings and its injunctions according to his intelligence." And this is something that was mentioned by the scholars of the past, which is called a person considering his intelligence to be good with regard to those affairs that were revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he makes his intelligence, he makes his aql, the judging factor in regard to the ahkam, the rulings and regulations. And this is something that we mentioned earlier when talking about qiyas. And we want to make clear this point a little further by saying that verily the first person to use this, to take this path of using his intelligence and using qiyas against and in contradiction to the ahkam of Allah, the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was Iblis himself. For verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to prostrate to Adam, and he himself refused, using his intelligence, thinking his intelligence to be good, using qiyas, which was based upon his ignorance, saying, "Verily I am better than him. He created me from the fire and he created him from the sand." So here he used his qiyas, he used his analogy, he used his intelligence, he used his aql against and in contradiction to the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyone who follows his course and follows his path of using his intelligence or using the qiyas, which is not based upon its firm principles, in contradiction to the sharia of Allah, in contradiction and against clear texts of Islam, then verily he is upon the same path of shaitan. But what should our position be? We should totally submit to the rules and regulations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily it's not befitting for a believer, man or female, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or his messenger has ruled in a certain affair, that they should have any choice in that matter. The ayah again says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily it is not befitting for a believer, male or female, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered an affair, that they should have any choice in that matter, but they should accept it with all submission. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and nay, by Allah, they do not believe until they make you a judge in between all of their affairs and they accept your decision with the fullest submission. So this is what is obligatory upon every individual Muslim, that he should accept all of the injunctions and the rules of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though they may be against his intelligence. And he should not use his aql, his intelligence or his qiyas, which is not based upon the correct principles, in contradicting the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No.
هذه أيها الإخوة في الله هي أصول أسباب نشوء البدع. وأسباب نشوء البدع وعواملها تنشئ بوجود البدع مضار وأخطارا ومفاسد، نجملها بالتالي. وقبل أن نذكر ذلك سنذكر كلمة قالها الإمام ابن قيم الجوزية، وهو تلميذ شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية وناشر علومه ومعارفه. يقول: أصل كل شر يعود إلى البدع، أصل كل شر يعود إلى البدع. لماذا؟ لأن هذه الشرور لا تنشأ بتنوع درجاتها وتعدد مراتبها إلا بسبب مخالفة الشرع، وأعظم أسباب مخالفة الشرع هو انتشار البدع. لذلك يقول شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله: إن البدع الدينية شر من المعاصي الشهوانية بإجماع الأمة. إن البدع الدينية شر من المعاصي الشهوانية بإجماع الأمة. وقال سفيان الثوري: البدعة أحب إلى إبليس من المعصية، فإن المعصية يتوب صاحبها منها، وأما البدعة فلا يتوب صاحبها منها. لماذا؟ لأنه يعتقد أنه على هدى، يعتقد أنه على صواب، يعتقد أنه على دين، فيبقى متمسكا بهذا الشيء، وبالتالي فلن يتوب ولن يرجع إلى الهدى والصواب. بانتشار البدع تقل السنن وتخفى ولا تظهر ولا تنتشر. وفي هذا يقول التابعي الجليل حسان بن عطية رحمه الله تعالى: ما أحدث قوم في دينهم بدعة إلا رفع الله مكانها سنة حتى تحيا البدع وتموت السنة. الأمر الثاني: تشويه جمال الإسلام وصورته النقية، بحيث تظن أعمال أهل الطرق الصوفية البدعية وأعمال أهل الأساليب الحزبية الذين يفرقون المسلمين ويشتتون كلمتهم ويفرقون جمعهم، يظن الناظر إليهم أن هذا من الدين، فإذا توهم أن هذا هو الدين نفر منه قلبه واشمأزت منه نفسه وتركه مبتعدا عنه محاذرا منه. فأسباب أو من أسباب من نتائج البدع ومضرها أنها تشوه جمال الإسلام وتنفر الناس عنه. نقطة ثالثة: أنها عن البدع سبب لرد الأعمال وعدم قبولها ورفضها من الله سبحانه وتعالى. ألا نرى أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول: من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فهو رد، أي مردود إلى صاحبه. فهذا المبتدع المسكين الذي يكد ويتعب ويجهد نفسه في التعبد لله ببدعة أو محدثة من الأمور، إذا به لا يستفيد من ذلك شيئا، إذا به يرد إليه عمله ويرفض في وجهه فعله وعبادته بسبب تنكبه للسنة ووقوعه في البدعة. وأما رابعا فلعل هذا هو أخطر وجوه مضار البدع، وهو أن البدعة سبب ينحجب من خلالها أو تنحجب من خلالها توبة العبد فلا يقبلها. وبذلك يقول عليه الصلاة والسلام: من ابتدع، أو إن الله احتجب التوبة عن كل صاحب بدعة حتى يدع بدعته. إن الله احتجب، أي منع، إن الله احتجب التوبة عن كل صاحب بدعة حتى يدع بدعته. فليتق الله عز وجل المبتدعون، وليخافوه وليرهبوا منه، وليتبعوا كتابه، وليتبعوا سنة نبيه عليه الصلاة والسلام، فإن في ذلك والله خيرا لهم وخيرا لمجتمعهم وخيرا لدينهم ونشرا لصافي إسلامهم وصحيح سنة نبيهم عليه الصلاة والسلام. وبقدر مخالفتهم لهذا ومغايرتهم عنه تنتشر البدع وتكثر مضارها ومفاسدها.
What we previously mentioned are the fundamentals, the fundamental reasons which innovations spread and occur. But now I want to mention some of the evil consequences and some of the evil effects of innovations after their spreading and falling into society, and of the evil and harmful effects. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says that Ibn al-Qayyim was a student of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, and he was the one that spread many of his books. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, "Verily, the origin of every evil goes back to an innovation." Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, "Verily, the origin of every evil goes back or returns back to an innovation." And that is because all of these evils with all of their different levels and different types, all of them are considered to be in disagreement with the Sharia of Allah. They are all considered to be in contradiction to the Sharia of Allah. And the greatest of all contradiction, or the greatest of all disagreements with the Sharia of Allah, is innovations. Verily, innovations in the religion are more evil than committing the desires, or committing sins based upon one's desires. And this is by the ijma' of the ummah. هذا خالد بقيم
من البدعي
من البدع الدينية
شاهد قال كلام شيخ الإسلام
الشيخ الإسلام رحمه الله شيخ الإسلام بن تيمية رحمه الله he said verily the innovations in the religion are more evil than the sins which are based upon one's desires. Those sins that are based upon one's desires, these innovations are more evil than them, and this is by the consensus of the ummah. And Sufyan al-Thawri رحمه الله one of the salaf said innovations is more beloved to shaitan than sinning, the falling into sins. Because the person who falls into sins, he may seek refuge, he may seek repentance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for these sins. But the person of innovations will never seek repentance from his sins. Because while he's doing these innovations, he thinks that he's upon the religion. He thinks he's upon the correct way. He thinks he is upon the Sharia. So now I want to mention some of the evil effects of innovations. The first of these evil effects of these innovations, when they spread into the Muslim community, is the absence or the ignorance of knowledge of this deen. So the sunnah becomes hidden. Sunnah becomes thrown away. And innovations become widespread. One of the salaf said, one of the tabi'een said, whose name was Hassan ibn Atiyah, he said, verily, no innovation comes about in this ummah except that it... No innovation comes about in this ummah except that a sunnah like it is removed from it. And it will remain in that situation until the sunnah is replaced. So this first evil effect of the innovation spreading in the society is that the sunnah becomes lost. The second evil effect of innovation is the beauty and the purity of Islam is destroyed by following this innovation. So all of these people and introduce these new affairs into this religion from the evil ways of the Sufiya and also the ways of those people who want to split up the Muslims, what in effect they are doing is destroying the beauty of Islam and its pure picture. The third evil consequence of innovation the Shaykh wanted to mention was the actions being rejected. The actions of this individual being rejected. This is because of the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that whoever does an action which is not in this affair of ours and invents a new action will have it rejected. So the third evil consequence of falling into innovation will be this person's actions will be rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will not be accepted. So this person who does this evil thing of falling into innovations, he works hard. And he tries hard in his innovations, but he does not reap the benefits of this. Rather, his actions are rejected in his face, based upon this hadith previously mentioned. The fourth consequence, or evil consequence, of innovations is, and this is probably the most dangerous of all consequences, and the most dangerous of all aspects of falling into innovations, is that this person is screened from the tawbah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is screened from the forgiveness and the repentance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, verily, Allah has screened between an individual who follows innovations and him and his tawbah being accepted until he leaves his innovation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, verily, Allah has put a screen between a person's tawbah, a person who commits innovation and his tawbah being accepted until he leaves his innovation. So, O servants of Allah, fear Allah, take care of his deen, follow the book and the sunnah, follow the kitab and the sunnah, and do not fall into innovations. This is better for you, and this is better for your deen, and this is better for the community at large. So just as a person may fall into differences and disagreements with the Sharia, then this is directly proportional to him falling into innovations.
وَأَمَّا طُرُقُ عِلَاجِ الْبِدَعِ وَالتَّخَلُّصِ مِنْهَا وَالْوِقَايَةِ من أضرارها فتتمثل في أمور. أما أول ذلك فهو أن يداوم العبد داعيا ربه سبحانه وتعالى أن يرزقه اتباع السنة واجتناب البدعة. فإن الدعاء هو العبادة كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام، الدعاء هو العبادة. ثم تلا قوله تعالى: وقال ربكم ادعوني أستجب لكم إن الذين يستكبرون عن عبادتي سيدخلون جهنم داخرين. فسمى ربنا سبحانه وتعالى العبادة دعاء، وجعل المستكبر عن هذه العبادة من الداخلين جهنم عياذا بالله تعالى. فالمسلم حتى يجعل أمره بيد ربه سبحانه وتعالى عليه أن يداوم على الدعاء، لا أن يظن بنفسه خيرا وأنه يستغني عن الله عز وجل، بل إن العبد لا وجود له ولا حياة له ولا بقاء له إلا بربه سبحانه وتعالى ودعائه له واستجابته له عز وجل. لذلك كان الإمام أحمد رحمه الله دائما يقول: اللهم أحيني على الإسلام والسنة. وكان دائما يكثر من الدعاء قائلا: الحمد لله على الإسلام والسنة. بل إنه سمع بعض أصحابه يقول: الحمد لله على الإسلام، قال: قل والسنة، قل والسنة. أما النقطة الثانية فهي الالتزام العملي، فهي عفوا متابعة العلماء وسؤالهم، متابعة العلماء وسؤالهم. والله عز وجل يقول: فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون. فمن لم يكن عنده العلم فليسأل أهل العلم وليتابعهم وليعرف ما يقولون فيه وفي أعماله، فإنه بمتابعته لأهل العلم يرشد نفسه ويسدد دربه ويستقيم طريقه. أما إذا استغنى عنهم وابتعد منهم فإنه سينحرف انحرافا خطيرا كثيرا، وهو يظن أنه من الذين يحسبون أنهم يحسنون صنعا. وها هنا الخطر الكبير بأشد ظلامه وظلمه أعاذنا الله وإياكم. أما النقطة الثالثة فهي الالتزام بالسنة والحرص عليها ما استطاع المسلم إلى ذلك سبيلا. لذلك يقول بعض أهل العلم، يقول: إنه لتمر بنا النكتة من القوم. والنكتة هنا بمعنى الفائدة، بمعنى الشيء الذي نراه حسنا ولا نعرف حكمه. قال: إنه لتمر بنا النكتة من القوم فلا نقبلها إلا بأحد شاهدين: كتاب الله أو سنة رسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام. والسنة بحمد الله تعالى أيها الإخوة قد أتت على حياة المسلم كلها، بحيث لا يغيب عنه حكم ولا يغيب عنه عمل إلا وللسنة فيه مكان وفيه بيان وفيه إلزام يكون من خلاله الهداية والسعادة كلها. والله عز وجل يقول: لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة لمن كان يرجو الله واليوم الآخر. والنقطة الرابعة تعلم العلم الشرعي، تعلم العلم الشرعي. لا يكتفي الإنسان بأن يسأل العلماء وإن كان في ذلك خير كبير، لكن عليه أن يتعلم العلم الشرعي، لأن تعلم العلم الشرعي، تعلم العلم الشرعي كما قلنا من علامات رضا الله عز وجل على عباده وإرادته الخير بهم، كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام في الحديث الذي ذكرناه: من يرد الله به خيرا يفقه في الدين. وعندما دعا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم للصحابي الجليل ابن عباس ماذا دعا له؟ قال: اللهم فقهه في الدين وعلمه التأويل أي التفسير. وأما النقطة الخامسة وهي التي نذكرها ونكررها دائما فهي تعلم اللغة العربية. فإن تعلم اللغة العربية من أعظم أسباب الوقاية من البدع والبعد عنها وعلاجها. وبقدر ما يكون الإنسان عارفا بلغة العرب وملتزما بالسنة وداعيا لربه ومتابعا للعلماء، بقدر ما يكون منه حرص على التسنن وبعد عن الابتداع في الدين. هذا أيها الإخوة في الله آخر ما أردت بيانه في هذه العجالة المختصرة وفي هذه الكلمة الموجزة، سائلا ربي عز وجل أن يثبتنا وإياكم على الإسلام والسنة وأن يميتنا على الإسلام والسنة، إنه ولي ذلك والقدر عليه. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
The Sheikh went on to say, as regards the ways we can cure the spread of innovations and put a barrier between them, we want to mention a few points in that disregard. The first point, which would be by way of curing the spread of innovations and saving us from falling into these innovations, is by constantly, continuously making dua of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He should grant us the following of the sunnah, and He should save us from falling into innovations. For verily, dua is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the authentic hadith states, the Prophet said, verily, ad-du'a al-ibadah, that verily making dua is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or is a form of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verily, it's from the best of all worships of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, call upon me and I shall answer you. Verily, those who are arrogant in worshipping me, then I shall put them into the hellfire. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls making dua worship. This ayah proves that this making dua is an act of worship. So we should continuously make dua to Allah. And should not think that we are in no need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or no need of His guidance. Verily we will not exist and will not remain in this way except by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam Ahmad, the Imam of Sunnah, he used to say continuously or very often, O Allah, grant me life upon Islam and upon the Sunnah. And one time Imam Ahmad heard one of his companions saying, O Allah, grant me life upon the Islam. And he said to him, and say as Sunnah as well, and say upon the Sunnah as well. The second point the Sheikh wanted to mention that is a reason for curing the spread of innovations and prevents us from falling into these innovations is by continuously following the scholars and asking them questions in our problems. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and ask the people of knowledge if you do not know. So verily the cure of ignorance is asking the scholars. And verily our path will not be correct, and we shall not remain upright until we remain following the scholars. We should not think that we do not need them, that we are free of any need of them. Rather, if we were to leave the scholars, then this would mean us falling into innovations and deviations. And this is a great, great danger. The third point is sticking to the Sunnah and being firm upon the Sunnah and taking care over the Sunnah. Some of the people of knowledge used to say that we go past a people and we find something good from them, and but we do not accept it from them until they bring two witnesses with it. Either an ayah from the Book of Allah or a hadith from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The people of knowledge would say that we would pass by a people and they would have some benefit, some good thing. They would have some kind of fayda to give us, but we would not accept this good thing from them until they bring two witnesses to prove what they're saying is good. Either an ayah from the Book of Allah or something from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So verily, the Sunnah has not left anything out. Every aspect of our lives, we find something from the Sunnah explaining its correct position and its rulings and regulations. The Prophet ﷺ said, verily you have in the Messenger of Allah the best example to follow. Allah ﷺ said, verily you have in the Messenger of Allah the best example to follow. The fourth point the Shaykh wanted to mention was, and something that we mentioned earlier also, is studying Islam correctly. So we should not suffice ourselves asking the scholars their questions. Rather, we should try and study Islam and study the rules and different sciences of Islam. And this is from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loving an individual. As we previously mentioned, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if Allah intends good for a person, He gives an understanding of the deen. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a dua for Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He said, O Allah, give him the understanding of his deen and give him the explanation of the Quran. The fourth point the Shaykh wanted to mention is something that he said that we mention often and very often indeed, and that is the importance of learning the Arabic language. For verily, this is the greatest of all ways of protecting ourselves from falling into innovations. So if a person, he follows all of these things by asking the people of knowledge, following the Sunnah, and studying Islam and learning the Arabic language, then we can say, inshallah, that he's taking care of his religion and maybe and has taken all the necessary precautions in order to stay away from innovations. The Shaykh then wanted to end his statement by saying, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us firm upon Islam and upon the Sunnah, and that he brings our death upon Islam and upon the Sunnah. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
JazakAllah khairan to the Shaykh. We're going to break here without taking the questions, as we have a session for questions at the end of the program, and all the questions we'll try and answer during that time. The next story will be at 3 o'clock after Dhuhr. JazakAllah khairan.